everybody. After the delicious lunch, we get down to the business of the policy scenario. I want to thank Education World for giving me this opportunity to meet practitioners like yourself. I think my introduction was given, but to my mind, the most important thing is I'm a Montessorian. Also, more importantly, a Montessori child. So my mother was a Montessorian, and I grew up with Montessori, so I'm very, very closely linked with the early childhood domain, and continue to do so through the policy perspective now, more than practice, unfortunately. So I'm going to give you an overview of the National Early Childhood Care and Education that Mr. Vivek Thakur referred to in the morning, both from perspectives of opportunities and challenges. So we all know that, you know, and I think I don't need to say this to a room full of ECD professionals, but the fact is that today, increasingly globally, we also realize that the first step to realizing the Millennium Development Goals is actually making sure that children not only have a right to preschool education, which is what a lot of you do, but also survival, because you do know that infant mortality rates are extremely high in our country. Development, overall development, many children don't live to see the light of their second birthday. Protection, we talked about that at length this morning, but protection even from neglect, because you often, if you walk driving down the street, you will find construction sites in cities like Mumbai where there will be no shelters for young children. Now, the children will be on the road, even though there is a policy and a legislation which says builders should actually have early childhood care shelters for children and the workers, the laborers. Health, nutrition, stimulation, which you all do, and of course, I think you've all spoken of participation. So this is just quoting the UNCRC. So if we look at early childhood, and if you're looking at ECC, which the national policy does refer to, this will encompass the whole gambit of care, protection, nutrition, play, learning, education, which is both inside and outside institutions. Because as we all realize and we've heard this morning from the panelists, the role of the home and the parent is absolutely vital. So given that we need to invest, I mean, and I think the question is, why in 2013 we have the first national policy for early childhood care and education? I think a lot of pressure comes from groups like yourselves when you come together, the ECA for example, but also I think globally it has been recognized through research that early childhood care and education is the only means of actually circumventing the intergenerational transmission of poverty. So how do we make sure that poverty does not move from one generation to another? The cycle of deprivation. And there's just a model in front of you, which will show you that if you have deprivation in early childhood, which is magnified undoubtedly due to gender, social groups such as Dalits, tribal children, children with disabilities, for example, malnutrition, you know, is the next common occurrence that you see in groups like that. Limited opportunities, therefore poor performance in school. These are the children who are often malnourished, do not get the right stimulation and support out of school, pushed out of school, do not have the skills to carry on into the labor market, and the intergenerational transmission of poverty continues. So I think governments all over the world recognize this, and pressure groups and lobbies by people like yourselves have helped in this.
So the policy background was that we had Article 45 of the Directive Principles in 1950. So our Constitution fathers actually wrote that the state shall endeavor to provide within a period of 10 years from the commencement of the Constitution for free and compulsory education for all children until they complete the age of 14. Now, this was 1950. So comes 2000 and we still haven't done that, right? And then we had the Unikrishnan judgment in 2001, which actually was the trigger for the constitutional amendment, which led to two articles. And I think this is a bit of a regression, by the way, rather than a move forward, because in one way, Article 21A introduced education for the first time as a fundamental right. And you all know the Right to Education Act, which says that all children from the ages of 6 to 14 will be provided free and compulsory education. But at the same time, we alter the earlier Article 45, which now reads, state shall endeavor to provide, just remember, the word is endeavor to provide early childhood care and education for all children until they complete the age of 6 years. I had a very interesting conversation over lunch where somebody asked me, what is this whole thing about age of entry into schools? And I said, the article constitutionally doesn't mention anything of age of entry, by the way. This is a state subject, right? Laws are made by states because it's a concurrent subject. All it says is that states shall endeavor to provide early childhood care and education for all children up to the age of 6. So what has happened here? Whereas our constitutional fathers wanted to provide all children up to 14 free and compulsory education, now you've taken away the rights of children under the age of 6 to free and compulsory education. Because the right to education is only for the age group 6 to 14. So to my mind, this is really not a step forward, because we have actually not understood all the global evidence that we have on the importance of early childhood. I'm not going to run through these, but you know, if you like the presentation, we will share it with you. Just a large number of articles and curriculum framework of the NCRT in 2000, Yashpal Committee report in 93, Acharya Ramamurthy Committee, the NCF 2005, all have referred to early childhood care and education as being very critical. I just want to mention the last three, just to, so that we come up to date. The national curriculum is being revised as of now. It is now in the midst of the new government reviewing it. But the last, and we've just written a position paper on early childhood care and education. It's not been put out into the public domain. This is before the last NCRT chairperson was pushed out. So I do not know what's going to happen with the position papers. But yes, I think all we did was we wrote about how important it was and the criticality of ECC. The Right to Education Act, of course, says under Section 11 that with a view to prepare children above the age of 3 years for elementary education and to provide ECC, appropriate governments may make necessary arrangements for providing free preschool education for such children. We also know that under the 25% reservation, a lot of seats have to now be allocated at age of entry in some states. You see, different states have made different rules according to the model rules of the RTE, which you all are very familiar with. But it's very interesting to see as though preschool education, particularly in this context, is seen as preparation for elementary education, not really as laying the foundation for what is going to happen. And you know, there is a big problem when we do things like readiness skills. You're almost as though not realizing that this is so critical important in itself. And I think it's very important to take cognizance of these, the language we use. The NCFT, which is the National Curriculum Framework for Teacher Education, actually referred to teacher education programs in ECE and said they should develop in trainees concepts, competencies, attitudes and skills related to implementation of DSE, which is developmentally appropriate curriculum-based, child-centered and play-based approaches. And the diversity that characterizes the ECE situation calls for development of multiple models of training of workforce with reference to age group, nature of programs, level of staff, mode and location of training. I mean, we all recognize that. I think there are so many models of teacher training for ECE. But just to share with you, this last week, there was this whole push for wanting to actually develop, just as the BEDs are being regularized and other teacher training programs are being regularized by NCT, we were very keen that the ECC curriculum also should be regularized and there should be one model that should be available through NCT. Work is still in progress, but there are really no players to take responsibility for teacher training. For ECE. Ministry of Human Resource Development said go to MWCD. Yeah, so we're kind of shuffling between. I just sent a note to someone to say, is there a TET exam which is going to now be there for, you know, the teacher eligibility test for ECC professionals? And I just got a response in my phone to say, there is no workforce in ECE. How can you have a TET? This is the workforce in front of you, and many, many more. But there is a dichotomy right now in terms of who do we believe is the workforce? The Anganwadi worker, is that the workforce you have? Those are the questions we need to ask policymakers, I guess. And of course, I think the biggest impetus for teacher training came from the Justice Verma Commission report, which said every pre-service teacher education institution must have a dedicated school attached to it as a laboratory, where student teachers get opportunities to experiment with new ideas and hone their capacities and skills to become reflective practitioners. I think this is such an important advice from the Justice. And imagine the Supreme Court of India has to come into the picture to actually make sure that we understand that laboratories are so important for teacher training. But thank God it's happened, and there is, because it's from the Supreme Court, we have to take and address these issues that are being raised. So, like I said, we have a bifurcation and fragmentation of policy with the 0 to 6s under the Ministry of Women and Child, and 6 and above with MHRD, Ministry of Human Resource Development. Now the question is, early childhood care and education everywhere in the world covers 0 to 8. In our country, there is a fragmentation, so the ECC policy only addresses 0 to 6. And leaves out those first 2 years of primary school, which everywhere in the world is known as the first last year of early childhood transitioning into primary education and young adulthood, early childhood. So look at the restructured ICDS. And, we heard this morning reference to the Integrated Child Development Services. It's globally acknowledged as the largest publicly sponsored integrated program for children under 6. Any document you read, there will be accolades because we managed to make it now universal almost according to the universalization principle that is being applied and the fact that ICDS is now in the mission since the last year and a half. So we have 1.34 million Anganwadis approved, I mean in present out of a total of 1.4 million approved. So there are still a few which have to come, you know, take, to develop totally on the ground. 22,000 creche centers. And if you look at the coverage of ICDS, 6 months to 6 years, which covers nutrition, lactating mothers, etc., the children
that we cover in ICDS now as of 2014 were 85.3 million. 47.4 million, 6 months to 3 years, which you would consider before preschool, and 37.9 million children, 3 to 6 years, which probably fall into the ambit of preschool education. Just remember, there is a feeding program, nutrition program, SNPL, that happens within ICDS. So a lot of these children are covered under the nutrition program, whoever is enrolled. So, as of 2013, covering rural children, said 64.5% 3-year-olds and 76.3%, that means almost 3/4 of 4-year-olds in rural India are either attending preschools. Now these preschools are private preschools. There are these low fee charging private preschools which have sprung up across the length and breadth of the country, or the Anganwari. So, which is good news. You know, so 3 out of 4 children in the 4-year-olds are actually attending preschool. And this excludes the urban population. Frankly, there are no estimates which you know, you can really say are the right estimates in terms of, you know, all kinds of figures for the private sector. And we've been telling the ministry, you must collect this data. There is a DICE data which today talks of 35% of the schools being private in the elementary arena. I'm sure they would be almost the same even in the preschool, or maybe, you know, maybe more, I don't know. So it's anybody's guess, you know, how many schools, preschools there are in the private sector, both the low fee charging as well as the ones that you all have, the quality benchmark, international or national preschools, many of you have got awards for. So of course, provisioning across ECC, and I won't spend too much time on this, but if we're looking at ICDS and how the ECC should be looked at, we should be looking at maternal health, maternal, you know, parenting education, which you all have been talking about, safe motherhood, right up to children getting opportunities to play, leisure, safety, security, responsive care, stimulation, but also about growing as individuals and being allowed to flourish. And that opportunity, I think, is still lacking for the poorest of poor. Because many unfortunate children just grow up on the streets in very, very remote rural areas where we, all these days, we were giving them mini Anganwadis. They weren't even getting a proper Anganwadi. Now, I don't know whether a proper Anganwadi also adheres to quality frameworks, but this mini Anganwadi never made sense. Luckily, now that is being addressed through the national policy. So what does the national policy say? It reaffirms, this is quoting the national policy, this is not my opinion, by the way. I'm not quoting the policy. It says, the policy reaffirms the commitment of the Government of India to provide integrated services for holistic development of all children from prenatal period to 6 years of age. This is a good thing that they're talking of prenatal, which means maternal care comes, you know, enveloped in this whole thing, which is very important. And the focus is on early learning. So for the first time, the national policy is talking of early learning. The vision is therefore to promote free, universal, equitable and contextualized opportunities so as to promote optimal development and active learning capacity of all children. So I think the policy for the first time reposits in the child. The power to learn and constructivism is at the core of the national policy because they do believe that there should be active learning, the child should be the creator of his own or her own learning, and they're looking at it as an indispensable foundation for lifelong learning. So the policy says very good things. It talks about implementation and monitoring of the policy through national and state early childhood care and education councils. How many of your states have got these councils in place? Anybody has any idea? Maharashtra is a very forward-looking state, I would think. No? Tamil Nadu has?
Tamil Nadu, okay. So 3 cheers for Tamil Nadu government. The national MWCD on paper is saying that they have constituted this. And we have no ideas who are the members, though we were told our names are on it. Nobody has told us that no meetings have been held. So much for the council. Did they also agree to develop national early childhood care and education curriculum framework, which is already being done? It's a good news. Quality standards have been made. Drafts are ready. They're on the website. They've been circulated to states and unions for preparation of action plans, PIPs. I don't know how much the state governments even interact with private players. I don't know. But many of you from the university departments might be involved in the PIP preparations. They have delegated entire power to the Union Ministry of Women and Child. And the aim is that they would be the nodal agency. Preschool is a very, very critical component in this policy. And of course, the fact is, if you look at number 6, which is very critical, the Anganwadi Center would be repositioned as a vibrant, child-friendly ECD center with adequate infrastructure and resources for providing this continuum of ECC in a life cycle approach. So, for the first time, the Ministry of Women and Child has given money for teaching learning materials. Many of you who have not been working with the government systems would not believe that there was no money allocated for even buying paper and crayons. For the first time, 3,000 rupees is now being given. So, you know, we are light years away from quality and providing materials or even looking at what is basic. And so we have a huge challenge in front of us to actually implement the policy. And then there is this very good initiative to convert a number of Anganwadis into Anganwadi cum creches. And this has been taken up back in a pilot mode already. A lot of states are working on it. I know Andhra Pradesh is here. Andhra Pradesh, they've taken up this pilot as well. And this is important because a lot of the mothers who are daily age work earners have no space to leave the children. And then the girl child is left behind at home to take care of the younger siblings. So this is a very critical pilot, and I hope this will be scaled up in years to come. So the first thing is, how would this happen? Because if we want millions of Anganwadis to suddenly become these very child-friendly and centers, we need people and we need resources. So NIPSID, which is the National Institute of Public Cooperation in Child Development, and its regional centers, is supposed to now operate helplines, counseling centers, capacity development centers, assessment centers, and advocacy hubs. Also, national and state ECC councils have to be watching all this, and data collection and generation is supposed to be managed. Parent and community outreach programs will be strengthened. So there is a huge push for doing a lot more campaigns, broadcasts, radio broadcasting, using puppetry in the villages. How do you reach out to parents is the idea. The question is, we are focusing on decentralization, and this is policy is supposed to be reviewed every 5 years with the, I told you, the ICDS mission steering group, and then the National ECC Council, State Council, and district level councils looking into all this. But in spite of the National ECC policy notified on 27 September 2013, like I said, National ECC Council notified on 26 February, we don't know who are the members. Quality standards for ECC having been drafted and the curriculum framework in place. I think there are huge issues regarding how we are going to implement what has been done. So we have made quality standards, and these are more than a one-time compliance. So this is like
an evolving process of quest for quality, and that is how it was envisaged. So the question was, can we have a graded system of accreditation? And that's where, by the way, the national policy is going to lead to. There will be some sort of accreditation at some stage, which will enable service providers to seek higher levels of accreditation. So this morning when you had awards, could the same thing be done for Anganwadi centers? Could we give recognition to Anganwadi centers who are performing really well? Because there are some brilliant people on the ground who, by the way, I feel extremely unhappy when I say this, but we expect this Anganwadi person to do all this. You have to see this. These are non-negotiable standards. ECC program of 4 hours duration. This is the size of the room is given, adequate outdoor space, trained staff. What does the staff pay? 3,000 rupees. Now, after a lot of fight. Are they even seen as regular government official? Personal? Of course not. Anganwadi is supposed to be a volunteer. But you put your children in the hands of this volunteer. And you expect this person to be looking at age and developmentally appropriate curriculum. Many of them are 8th standard or 10th standard pass. For the first time, the government has said they need to be 12th standard pass. I'm not sure whether we're going to get enough people in very, very remote tribal areas who are 12th class and who would be willing to do this sort of work. They need to know what developmentally appropriate trigger training material is. They need to make sure there is, you know, you're looking at a 1 to 20 adult-child ratio for the 3 to 6 age group, and under 3 is 1 to 15. But the question is, how are we going to meet these non-negotiable standards, given, and we also got these assessment cards. These are all on the website of the Ministry of Women and Child, so if any of you are interested, which encompasses physical, cognitive, language, social, emotional, creativity. All these have been, you know, put in there so that the Anganwadi worker has to start looking at all these different dimensions for children. So given the diverse situation in our country, how do we make this a reality is a question. And I'm going to just give you the scale of things. So with child population 0 to 6 at 158 million, which is 13%, with Uttar Pradesh child population being equal to the population of Pakistan, Assam's child population being equal to the population of Iraq, and never mind the rest, Maharashtra's child population being equal to the population of Iran, how do we make sure that we meet all these goals that we've set for ourselves? Diversity, huge diversity, intrastate, inter-district, from one block to the other, languages. So it's not easy. Even while we were developing the quality standards, the national curriculum framework, we were constantly saying, how will this work for a Santhali child? How will this work for a child in a rural slum of Mumbai? You know, so there are huge complexities in a country like ours, and there are no easy answers. But the challenge, once again, I just want to go back to that slide, is one of how do we make sure we cover all children? I just said, if Asar is saying 3/4 of children in rural areas are in preschool, how do we make sure 100% children in both urban and rural areas? And my gut feeling is it will be more difficult in cities and urban metros. Slum children, you're going to have even more difficulty. Street and working children, look at the large numbers. How do we cover those numbers? So it's not as, you know, as though just getting an Anganwadi in place is going to make sure children are going to come. And if they come, how to ensure inclusion and equity? Since morning, I was very interested when I heard that one of the parameters for your school, you know, awards was children with special needs. I was intrigued to hear that. And I'm wondering how, you know, whether we should make that a criteria for the school coming first. They have to adhere to that one. Because those are the children who are
You know, should it become a criteria which says this is a must, which means you start, because often there is a fear, we don't know enough. But it's, once the children come in, you learn through common sense approach of how to deal with children. So if a child has visual impairment, of course the child is learning through tactile. You know, is learning through oral and through other senses. So how do we also open our minds and hearts? And so the question is, will it be inclusive? Will we have access which is equitable? Will there be quality assurance? And of course, we have huge challenges of space and infrastructure. So, for example, we do know, I'm going to skip this, look at the quality that we might have. So you might, this picture on your left-hand side, top-hand corner, is from an Anganwari, and you can see there is no teacher, no adult. There's an older girl sitting there, watching over the children. And if you have preschools, lot of children. The other issue is, lot of states actually allow five-year-olds to enter grade one. So today when I read the newspaper, it said, you know, you cannot take children before the age of X, and six-year-olds have to enter grade one, and I'm wondering whether governments are going to now change their entry criteria to grade one, because that's the whole issue. Many states, in fact, I think 27 states allow children to enter grade one at age five. So all state rules will now have to be changed also. So there are huge repercussions on, you know, when we don't think through policies and how to look at implementation. So just quickly to say, we do know that from research, and I won't get into, you know, the details of research, but if you look at this Heckman has done a huge amount of work on rate of return on human capital investment at different ages. And you can see that the programs targeting 0 to 3 years have even more return than the 4 to 5, than schooling, which is, you know, 6 to 14, to post-schooling, which is job training and skill development. I wish our policymakers could look at existing research and therefore invest in what is important, because by not investing in early childhood, just look at the rates of dropout. This is an SRI, MRB study done for the Ministry of Human Resource Development. So almost 14% children dropping out at grade one. Another 20 by grade 2, and yet another 19.5 at grade 3, yes? And in rural areas, you know, in fact, it's not as bad as the urban areas where the dropouts are much higher. A quarter of the, you know, look at this, 17% in grade 1, another 24% in grade 2, another 22% of the leftover. This is cumulative. So, how do we therefore invest in making sure that children not only enter schools but remain in school? That is so critical. I just want to share some of the research that I'm doing on the young lives, and I'm not presenting any of that today, but just talking to parents, one of the parents, and ours is a pro-poor sample, we are following 3,000 children in each of the four countries, 12,000 children from 2002 to 2017. So we are seeing them grow, and we're going back to the families on a regular basis. So one of the parents says, in our village, Anganwari teachers are not good. Sorry, there's an R missing. We just send them so that they get used to the routine of going to school. Vishnu is a seven-year-old. This is a boy in Srikakulam who studies in the local Anganwari before moving to a government primary school. His parents are daily wage earners, and his mother shares she would prefer to send their son to a private boarding school, and describes the quality of education in both Anganwari and village primary school as mediocre. Not much is taught there. Few things like singing, they only feed and send back. That is why we want to shift him. And luckily ITDA has a lot of hostels now for tribal children, so most parents want to send their children to the ITDS hostels. So public funding, as Mr. Dilip Thakur said this morning, is a huge problem. And in fact, if you look at the whole WCD budget for ICDS, much of that goes into this 3,000 rupee honorarium to the Anganwadi workers and the helpers. So how much is spent on quality and what inputs for the child is further desegregation of the budget needs to be done on that. There isn't, you know, adequate training, certification and incentives for the ACC practitioners like I mentioned before. How can you expect, you know, in such miserly sums for people to be working and taking care of the next generation? And what is the capacity building that you are doing for them? That is more important. Still, I think attention to marginalized and disadvantaged groups like children with disabilities, those indigenous communities, say, in, for example, Andaman and Nicobar, there are so many indigenous communities. We have not reached out to them. We don't even understand their culture. So are we making sure that the states, at the national level, we can't have, we can only have a curriculum framework, but what do states do? How decentralized is the curriculum planning going to be, I think, is a critical issue. And coordination between sectors is extremely weak, especially for services of children aged 0 to 3 and then moving on to preschool. No data available, frequently available information is scattered across ministries and agencies. And therefore, children are subject to multiple disadvantages. So if you're a girl child, you're a tribal, you have disability, and you're poor. You can imagine the layers of marginalization that this child goes through. And how does a preschool teacher, is she or he prepared and made ready for capacity building to even address these multiple layers of marginalization? So we often, I was just saying to someone, it's so easy for us to talk having eaten such a brilliant meal. But if I'm a hungry stomach and I have to talk about ECC, I might have a different take on it. So I think the question is, do we allow multiple responses and multiple stakes? And how do we ensure that, you know, we are able to look at a broader service orientation, include families and local communities, because I think our biggest resources, especially in disadvantaged communities, are the parents and the larger communities. How do we have targeted social policies for vulnerable families? Because it's not just the child. You've also got to look after other aspects of the family. So how do we make sure that social protection mechanisms are in place? I'm going to skip over these. But I'm just going to raise this issue that there has been earlier, there was an ECE component under the right to education. For example, 13% of all schools have a pre-primary facility, government schools, in the country. Like I mentioned before, 23 out of the 35 states have 5 years as official entry for primary schooling. Today, there is this whole thing of let the pre-primary class get out of the government school. This is the government sector response. They don't want to keep the pre-primary. And actually, the pre-primary classroom really helped children move on. So there is a huge issue here. So I think extension of early childhood until age 8 is absolutely essential, but also looking at quality assurance, bringing in the private players, I think, to actually hold hands with the government to adopt Anganwadi centers near your schools, I think would be a huge step forward. All of you could adopt the nearest Anganwadi center. Look at some cross-fertilization to happen, because your teachers and children would also learn a lot from just being with who we other all the time, you know, rather than the othering that we do. And I think training programs and, of course, salaries for ECC professionals definitely need certain norms. I just want to end with Kofi Annan's words, who said, "There is no trust more sacred than the one the world holds for children. There is no duty more important than ensuring that their rights are respected and their welfare is protected." So if we want to really adhere to what the Millennium Declaration said, which said we have a collective responsibility to uphold the principles of human dignity, equality and equity at the global level, and we therefore have a duty towards the most vulnerable, particularly the children of the world to whom the future belongs. I think that the ECC policy is the first step, but all of us have to join hands to make it happen. Thank you very much.
Hi, Renu. Thank you, because I think you speak very passionately about the policy. And your point is absolutely right, which the EC has always told the people in this audience, please adopt the name Sanghamari, because it's all children should move forward together, not only the rich. Apart from that now, we've been debating on this topic since many years about how to improve the status of early childhood education in this country. Our suggestion going forward, and we want you and a lot of other stakeholders like Education World to tell us if that is a possibility. You said that education, pre-primary education, is a state subject. It's concurrent, right? Can't we not have it as a state subject? And shouldn't the policy passed at the center be applicable in all states, depending on the language of the state? But if you are saying that a child of 3 to 6 years or 0 to 3 years needs this, then how is the Tamil Nadu deciding differently for its 0 to 3 years? Because development is same all over the world. So if the UN is declaring a kind of a policy, why is India allowing its states to make their own rules and regulations? And let me give you an example of Maharashtra. Pre-primary education, Mr. Tawde, who's our new education minister, when we go to him and say about pre-primary, who's going to regulate, he says, "Woh hamare andar nahi hai." But when it comes to fee regulations or age regulations, they pass GRs, that this is what you're supposed to do. So my question to you, because you're so involved with policy at the government level, shouldn't we now be working towards ensuring that the policy, the wonderful policy passed by the Women and Child Development Ministry, is applicable in its purest form in all the states?
I think that's a very important thing. The reason why education, our constitution, you know, our fathers who wrote the constitution thought of education as a concurrent subject. It's not really the states only, it's concurrent. So what happens is a national policy is made at the center, but state policies also need to be made. Now the state policy should actually be a step further to the national policy. That's the problem. When it was envisaged as a concurrent subject, the idea was there will be some broad framework laid out, because you don't want to be prescriptive and use a top-down approach. But a decentralized planning mechanism would further strengthen what has come from the center. Unfortunately, we have not invested in the capacities of the regional centers of NIPSED. Actually, I think that's a major issue, because the regional centers should be now taking the lead. Who's going to do it? Who's going to take the lead? With universities, with other child development partners like yourselves, I think there are people with such good experience in our country who understand child development. We don't need people to come from Delhi or anyone. Within the states, you have enough people. Why can't it be a partnership? So, for example, when the national policy also was being rolled, the draft was being, vetted, there were regional consultations held in all states, in all the regions. Huge amount of inputs came from the region when the consultations were held. Similar consultations should have been held now for making the state plans. That is now, you see, not being led by the center. I think what you're saying, and I hear you say, is till the states are ready, we may need to do more hand-holding.
Basic foundational requirement of every child, whether the child is born in Tamil Nadu or Ahmedabad or Mumbai.
Yes.
So why are we leaving it to the state's whims and fancies that, okay, either quality do, either mat do? You know?
I will take this back.
We are trying to push. In fact, ECA is in the discussion stage right now amongst the committee members. And maybe we push the government maybe to pass something like an ordinance or something, because early childhood has to be common all across the country.
Absolutely, I agree with you. But it should, there should be certain amount of diversity and indigenous wisdom which must be, you know,
developed. From the foundation.
Yes.
And then diverse.
Yes. I think there is someone at the back.
Yeah.
Yes, lady at the back. Okay, okay.
Hello, good evening, good afternoon. I'm Sushila from Save the Children India. We are an NGO running about 225 Balwadis in Mumbai, in the government school premises as well as in the slum communities. And these Balwadis are also almost like Angarwadis. And then when we are talking about, we are discussing about whether the pre-primary education responsibility is a state's responsibility or a central's responsibility, is a very conflicting subject, and that this is going on and on and on. When we face the government, we need a policy document, it throws us to a women and child department, which is again managed by center. ICDS is a centrally managed body. And the Balwadi's teacher salaries and Balwadi budget is coming from Sarva Shiksha Abhiyan, which is again a center managed body. So how it comes, like a state has to manage, there should be a uniform policy for across the country, which all states should have a mandatory to be followed, and maybe 80%, 20% leverage can be given to a state to customize it to their own needs or their own geographical needs. That's what I have to come.
Thank you.
In addition to this, what Swati ma'am said, the regulatory body has to be centralized. Otherwise, each state will have their own priorities. And then we will be in a very chaotic state, and we don't know how to standardize this whole initiative. That's one. Secondly, I have a question. I have gone through the national framework that has been developed. And right now, we are at a stage, we are actually developing the curriculum that includes daily lesson plan, then monthly and annual lesson plan. What we are thinking, that with the support from ECA as a platform, we would like to give it to the Central Minister of Women and Child Development, saying that this is something which is 80:20 ratio. This should be mainstream across India. And then only we can think of standardization. This is what we are thinking at it.
So actually, we have had different people try out curriculum development in all the states. I think 15 states, including Maharashtra, there were model curriculums have been developed. If you go to the WCD, they will share them with you. So those are now, they were piloted. It was in a pilot phase the whole of last year. The, you know, CECDR and CECD did West Bengal, Rajasthan, Assam, Haryana, Delhi, you know, so lots of states have been covered. In fact, I think 13 states have been covered.
16 states were covered.
Yeah, so those curriculums are already there. Now
it's a framework. What we are talking about, it's a framework. It's not a...
No, we're talking of lesson plans, everyday lesson plans.
The which is there in Women and Child Development website.
It's at the ministry. You can check with the ministry.
Yes, yes. I did that. It's a framework.
I think there was a question from you.
Ma'am, in continuation with just what Swati said, you know, in today's paper, in continuation with just what Swati said, the problem is that state government says the child should be entering to a formal school at the age of 3, whereas the central government says the child should be entering class 1 at the age of 6. So there is like 3 years gap in between, where ideally it should be just 2 years gap. So is it possible that the child should be entering a formal school at the age of 4 and it should be uniform across all the states all over India?
I think Maharashtra has now passed a government order for this session. Yeah? What age is that, Swati?
3?
Okay, so Maharashtra, you see, again, like I said, this is...
Ma'am, but the policies are contradicting. You know, the central government says something else, state government says something else, so there has to be some mechanism.
They know this. They are aware that 27 states start, I told you, primary education at 5. So when they pass the 6 to 14, thinking that 6 was age is actually not true on the ground. Andhra Pradesh has been taking 5-year-olds for years.
So, ma'am, this is what we are saying, when you're sitting at the central government and you're making policies, keep these things in mind and then, you know, guide the state governments accordingly.
So this is a contradiction in policy which unfortunately remain. That's the problem. Absolutely.
Hello, I'm Jaya. I represent Tamil Nadu, and we are going through some tough times right
can
now.
Can you just a little louder, sorry?
Yeah, can you hear me? Yeah. So I said there is now the current policies and procedures, and I think it has reached the GO level at in Tamil Nadu. There is a whole lot of in early childhood, basically in preschool until preschool. They're very confused whether should they take it until 3, no schooling at all, and there was an order issued that all the play schools should be closed. And then we went petitioning, we went with the at the top level, and negotiations were going on. They invited us to form the policies. Still nobody is clear. They call us, get some input, then we don't know what's happening. And my thing was that if on one hand, we are talking about freedom of education to the kids until 6, how important it is to be creative, how not to pressurize them. And then if you are going to look at a formal education, which is in a regular school system, and if you those kids are going to a regular school, there is no reforms or nothing there at that time. And those children are in normal, where they start writing at the age of 2.5 and 3. And it is even more burden because the adult-child ratio in those kind of schools are 1:30, 35, and 40. And there is so much of a disconnect between K through 12 schools and play school to preschools. The reason that parents send these kids to us is to give us individualized attention. And that's something that is absolutely missing in, regular school system. So, how is the government trying to address this issue?
A lot of research has shown that composite schools, integrated schools, actually have a much better retention rate. At least that's the research that we got from NUPA. And I think the issue here is you may not have composite schools, a universal coverage with composite schools. I know CBSE schools will be mainly, largely composite schools. But I think the question is there is a place for everybody and there isn't enough research evidence to show that they are not good. Some certain schools might be better. I'm not sure whether we've taken all government schools to say they are better. Is it the private schools only which are better? Are there certain kind of private school which is better? So I think much more evidence needs to be gathered before we can really look at this. But this is a very interesting area to definitely follow up on.
Because right now the way they are heading it is almost like closing of a blanket order. That is what they had told us earlier. To close all preschool, preschool, and there cannot be any preschool. So if you guys can do something at the center, that would be really
useful. You should ask them, where is the evidence to show that these don't contribute? You should ask them. Government should at least base their government orders on evidence. It can't be just, one of those, I feel this doesn't work. So you should ask them for the evidence.
Thanks.
And maybe you should gather evidence yourself. That's something I just wanted to say. I don't know how many of you actually do action research. I think that's something all of you must indulge in. Because you have so many thousands of children who pass through your system. Why can't you all come together, gather evidence of how you contribute?
We did it.
You know, that is really...
We did it. We did a presentation for them too.
Right.
Okay, last question.
All right, this is not a question. It is a sharing. We are a team from Sophia Nursery School, functioning at the Sophia campus in Mumbai. And I just want to share with you all that for the last 20 years, we have a Balwadi where we are teaching about 35 to 40 children with 3 trained teachers at par with our 10 sections, which is the regular school, nursery school. We give them all the facilities at subsidized rate, and by the time they go out from our Balwadi, they are ready to be integrated into the high school. So this was just a sharing. We are doing our bit, all the domestic, the chauffeurs, the grocer, whoever, you know, at a subsidized rate. And we try to do it, so this is that we are doing it. Let other private schools also carry on with this good work.
I just hope, this is wonderful to hear. I just hope you would also not have separate section for them. Include them all together.
Integrated fully, but okay. Section separate, because when they come, their language is a little,
in the beginning.
Yes.
The beginning.
And we do everything together. The children never feel that this is the Balwadi and, you know, we are from the little upper strata. We do all activities, everything for them at par with the other children. With the other 130 children, these 35-40 children stand equal to them. And they get into the best schools of Mumbai.
Thank you for sharing that.